moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till Jesus comes.
Let's go back to Chronicles. Because the Levites will, matter of fact, he not only had how it was supposed to be carried, he said who was supposed to carry it. The Levites was supposed to carry it. Let's go back, because David was troubled at this. And he called that place Para-Uzzah. All right? Because that's where Uzzah was stricken down. Okay? So, he figured it out. And he did things in a proper order. This is 1 Chronicles 15:1. And David made him houses in the city of David and prepared a place for the ark of God and pitched for a tent, for it a tent. Then David said, none ought to carry the ark of God but the Levites. For them hath the Lord chosen to carry the ark of God and to minister unto him forever. So that's who he had carrying it. Okay? So then he called all the Levites, so he sanctified them. And in let's go down to verse 12. It says, and said unto them, ye are the chief of the fathers of the Levites. Sanctify yourselves, both ye and your brethren, that ye may bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel unto the place that I have prepared for. Okay? So verse 14, it says, so the priests and the Levites sanctified themselves to bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel. And the children of the Levites bear the ark of God upon their shoulders with the staves thereon, as Moses commanded according to the word of the Lord. So you have to do things according to the word of the Lord. All right? See, that's how it goes. Let's go to verse, let's skip down, because they were successful. Verse 25. So David and the elders of Israel and the captains over thousands went to bring up the ark of the covenant of the Lord out of the house of Obed-Edom with joy. And it came to pass when God helped the Levites that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord that they offered 7 bullocks and 7 rams. Okay? And it says in verse 29, and it came to pass as the ark of the covenant of the Lord came to the city of David. Okay, that Milcah, the daughter of Saul, looking out of the window, saw the king David dancing and playing, and she despised him in his heart. But he was happy. He was pleased because they had done things in a proper order. Okay? They had done things in a proper order. And that's when you should praise God. You have to praise him with understanding. See, at first, they lacked the understanding that the Levites were supposed to carry this. You cannot worship God any kind of way. He gave you guidelines on how to worship him. So how you have the audacity to take pagan days, associate them with the Messiah, the one that came to die for the sins of the world, and call yourself praising him is beyond me. Once you have that understanding, you need to leave it alone. It's one thing you can not know, but you still pay for not knowing. In all aspects of life, ignorance you pay for. Same thing with God. You need to seek God and find out what he requires. It's not hard to find out that Christmas is pagan. We read, I don't know how many encyclopedia passages. So you need to seek God and find that out. Let's go to another place. Let's go to Leviticus, the 10th chapter. And read the account of Nadab and Abihu. Because Nadab and Abihu, they were some of the ones who in Exodus, I believe the 24th chapter, went and saw God and ate with God. They saw God. Listen to what happened to them when they did something out of order as far as worship. This is Leviticus, the 10th chapter, in the first verse. It says, and Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them their censer, because they were given things to do. They were Levites, the sons of Aaron. And put fire therein, and put incense thereon, and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. So they did something that was not commanded by God. And let's find out what happened to them. And there went out fire from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. So the Lord killed them on the spot, just like he killed Uzzah on the spot. Death is coming your way if you continue in this foolishness. Verse 3. Then Moses said unto Aaron, this is it that the Lord spake. So he had a message from the Lord to Aaron, because these are Aaron's sons. You know he's feeling distraught. It says, this is what the Lord had to say. I will be sanctified in them that come nigh me or near me. And before all the people, I will be glorified. And Aaron held his peace. So don't even say anything about your sons being killed, because they did things out of the proper order. You have to understand, he's the God of this creation. You cannot worship him any way you want to. Who is the God? How is he your God if you don't worship him how he said worship him. Don't call on the name of Jesus. That's as Paul preached another Jesus. Call on Adonis or Tammuz or Nimrod or Addis, some other God. Don't say you're worshiping the birth of Jesus. Call it what it is. You're worshiping the Saturnalia festival. Right? Call it what it is. You're commemorating the birthday of the unconquered son. That's what you do on these days. Let's go to one more place, Leviticus, the 23rd chapter. Because if you want to do things in a proper order, and you want the days, those days that we should commemorate and celebrate are in Scripture. And some might say those feast days were nailed to the cross. First of all, that's a lie. Okay? Jesus kept, you can read Luke, the 4th chapter, his custom was to keep the Sabbath day. You say, okay, well, once he died, that was done. But Paul kept the Sabbath day. Alright? Paul kept the feast days. He said, everything that's written in the law and the prophets, I believe. Alright? The Lord Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. He did not do away with any of these days. You can read about it and believe in Zechariah, the 14th chapter. Even when he comes back, people are going to go up from year to year to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. So how are you going to do away with God's feast days and then on top of that add another one? Sunday or Christmas or Easter. All that's pagan. That's how Satan has deceived the whole world, brothers and sisters. This is Leviticus, the 23rd chapter. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, concerning the feast of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations, even these are my feasts. There is no such thing as a Mosaic law. The law was given to Moses to give to Israel, but it was given by God. Moses didn't make up anything. He was given it by God. That's why the Lord said, these are my feasts. These are not the feasts of the Jews or the Israelites. These are the feasts of God. So he tells us what days we should commemorate. Verse 3. First of all, he deals with the weekly feast or Sabbath day. He says, 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of rest and holy convocation. You shall do no work therein in the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings. So you're supposed to honor the seventh day and rest on that day. Alright? So that's the weekly Sabbath, but then he has annual Sabbaths. Because that weekly Sabbath, that seventh day, points to that thousand-year millennium period, that rest to come, that man has been working to get to, where it's going to be peace on the earth, where the wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the child shall take up the asp in the hand like a toy. It's going to be peace on this earth. That's what the seventh-day Sabbath points to. All right? So he talks about the feast of the Lord that come every year. He says in verse 5, in the 14th day of the first month, that even is the Lord's Passover. Okay? That's the day in which you read about it in Exodus, I believe the 12th chapter around there. It talks about how the Israelites, they put the blood of the lamb over that doorpost. Okay? And they had to sacrifice a lamb. And they didn't break any of the bones of that lamb. Just how Jesus' bones were not broken. Because Jesus is that lamb. He is that lamb, and we must come under his blood, just how they put the blood over the doorpost. If you want salvation, want to be saved, you have to come under the blood of Jesus. Okay, so right after that, okay, and now we don't sacrifice anymore, you take the blood and the wine. Okay? I'm sorry, the wine represents the blood, and the flesh represents, or the bread is represented by his flesh. Okay, we take the wine and the bread. All right, excuse me. And it says, and on the 15th day of the same month is the feast of unleavened bread unto the Lord. 7 days you must eat unleavened bread. Okay? So what you must do with unleavened bread, leaven represents sin. You need to get rid of all the sin, all of the false doctrine, anything contrary to God out of your life once you come under that blood. See, his days show the salvation for man. Then after that comes, it says in verse 15, and ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath, from the day that ye brought the sheep of the wave off, and 7 Sabbaths shall be complete. Okay, you have that Feast of Weeks, okay, or Pentecost. And that day commemorates people coming into the God family. Okay, because Jesus was the first fruits, the first begotten of the dead, first indicative of many more to come. So you come under the blood of Jesus. You get away from all the sin. You get all of that out of your life. And you consume his word, unadulterated and uncut. Not adding Christmas or Easter or any kind of false doctrine. And he says, you're going to be a part of this. Just like he was accepted, you will be accepted. Had he not been resurrected, we could not be resurrected. Okay? So then you go to the Feast of the Trumpets, it says in verse 23. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall ye have a Sabbath, a memorial, blowing of trumpets, and holy convocation. Many things are going on at the sound of a trumpet. The Lord is coming back to wage war at the sound of a trumpet. The Lord is coming back to...